nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to Unit 3 of Nanophotonic Modeling. So we're going to start Lecture 3.1 with an introduction to the topic of finite difference time domain and generally solving differential equations in both time and space. So what is finite difference time domain, if you haven't heard of it before? So basically the concept is very simple, which is that we want to solve the actual electric and magnetic fields over time. And so, of course, as you know, Maxwell's equations give you explicit expressions for the time and spatial dependence of both electric and magnetic fields. So here, basically, the trick is to discretize time and space on a certain type of lattice, which is called the E lattice, which gives us better accuracy than using just an arbitrary choice. And basically, what this amounts to is what's called a leapfrog time evolution. And so the key thing there is that you would actually alternate solving the electric and magnetic fields in time by stepping through actually half a time step between each. And so, as you know, since electric fields create magnetic fields and vice versa, then you go back and forth. So this is actually a very good approach for optics, and it gives you better accuracy than you'd get with an arbitrary approach. So as you reduce the increment of time, basically the size of the time step, then the accuracy goes up as 1 over delta t squared in principle. And this has been implemented in software multiple times. So I don't want to say this is the only implementation, but one implementation that I have been involved with is called MEEP. And this is available on the MIT website, jdjmit.edu/meep. And there's also a nanoHUB tool to implement this as well. So in order to kind of set the stage for creating the actual set of differential equations or difference equations that we use for finite difference time domain, I'm going to take a step back in some sense and talk about how we solve ordinary differential equations before in the next lecture we go into partial differential equations in more detail. So if you think about just a standard ODE solver, which has like a single time derivative, okay? So dx dt equals some f of x, which could just be as simple as x, which would make it an exponential time dependence, or it could be something more complex, of course, like maybe nonlinear. But in any case, you want to solve this with the greatest accuracy and least computational cost. So of course, ideally, this would be something you can solve analytically, but let's assume for the moment that there's no analytical solution. Then we need to solve it computationally. And so then we can basically, before we actually try to set up our computational problem, we can think about like what are the boundary conditions. And so we could have initial value type problem where we get initial set of values and then we propagate those through time. Or we could actually have something that's a little different called the boundary value problem, where we're actually told like there are certain constraints on certain values which are probably on the boundaries. And so there are a whole bunch of algorithms that have been developed to address ordinary differential equations. One of the most obvious ones are either the Euler methods or the shooting methods, where you would basically just take the differentials and then turn them into deltas. So you would say delta x equals f of x times delta t, right? So it's a very simple rearrangement of this equation here, right? And so that, of course, makes sense. It's very intuitive, but the challenge is it's not always the most accurate. So then higher order methods, such as the Runge-Kutta or Runge-Kutta method, actually would kind of break up your time step into multiple sub-steps, and then they would carefully add them together for higher accuracy. But there's actually another approach, which we'll talk more about in the fourth unit, which is using finite element and difference methods to actually break up your problem in non-uniform ways. In some cases, that can be more effective than just having more uniform time intervals. So this is just showing briefly like what is the Euler method, which I mentioned earlier. So it's very fast and easy to implement, but oftentimes it's inaccurate for many ODEs. And so basically the reason why it doesn't always work is because it assumes that everything is evolving linearly with time, right? And so you can imagine that if something is having a large degree of curvature, it can be easy to overshoot. And so once it overshoots, then your accuracy goes down tremendously, especially if you have very sharp curvature, right? And so that basically forces you then to slow down the time step to whatever's like kind of the tightest curve in the whole system. And so if it just happened like at one value of x, that's enough to throw off the whole solution. Now, of course, like I mentioned, there are these higher order methods. In principle, if you have incorporated up to the nth derivative, then the error should go as 1 over delta t to the n plus 1th. And so then this actually sets the stage for using a leapfrog method, in which we would not only look at the value itself iterated over time, like in the Euler method, but also its first derivative. And so here we can think of Newton's equations of motion. And so, of course, we know that typically we'd say that the acceleration a equals f over m, right? And we'll assume for now that m equals 1. And so then we can actually, instead of just writing that directly as like a second derivative in time, we can actually write it as two first order derivatives in time. And so we have dx dt equals v, right? And so that's a standard definition of velocity. And then we have the dv dt, which is also acceleration equals f from f equals ma. And so if we actually write it like in this form, then you can see that we have kind of this simple matrix algebra type representation for the problem where we can write this as like our capital X vector, right? So we have d capital X dt equals some f of x in general, right? Where, of course, like x and v are both components of x, so it makes sense. And then we would now alternate between updating x and v. And so the rationale for doing that, of course, is that especially if the force is not uniform, then we can actually capture this like to the second order in time when we update xi and then we update vi. So of course vi is integrated with respect to delta t, but now we can actually more realistically capture like these acceleration effects. And so the error of this approach should go, because we have like the first derivative as well, like 1 over delta t squared. And so this approach is essentially the foundation for the finite difference time domain as well. Now, of course, you can also go to higher order methods, and we'll talk about that a little bit as well later in this unit, like the Runge-Kodé method, which I mentioned earlier. It's implemented in MATLAB, even if you didn't know it, as ODE45. And so this basically tries to add, in general, incremental slopes in between the initial time and then delta t. So these AIs are usually all less than 1. And then you also have like these subintervals in the y, basically the response as well. And so then the overall solution of your system depends on delta t, but also the sum over these k's that are going into your y solution up here with another set of coefficients, ci. And obviously, I haven't gone into all the details of how AI, BI, J, and CI are related, but you can certainly look that up. And you'll find that the order of the solution would be equal to M. So if you have M subintervals, then you have M derivatives as well. And so then the accuracy goes as 1 over delta T to the M plus 1. And so if you have a fourth order derivative, then it's accurate to 1 over delta T to the fifth. And then finally, I wanted to mention that you have numerical ODE solvers, like stiff solvers, oftentimes that would use backwards differentiation to kind of cope with the rapid curvature of the system. And so sometimes, although this is a little more work to also propagate forward and backwards, it can give you convergence that's order of magnitude better. So the overall time that it takes to run is much better. And so then there's this stiff solver in MATLAB called ODE15S that you could use to do this. And so, of course, we're going to now try to apply this to Maxwell's equations, this sort of approach. Now, of course, the main thing you notice about Maxwell's equations is that they have kind of derivatives in space and time, so you can't necessarily directly apply that. But in the next lecture, we'll explain how that works.